It's me! It's me from middle school! I was so lame!
Huh? Stop calling me that. At least not when we're out in public.
Takemichi. Starting today, we're friends. Yeah?
Heh. Hey everyone, I'm Jackie Jing with Anime News Network, and super excited because I am talking about a spectacular show today, Toyo Revengers, and even more amped because I get to talk to the English voice cast. Oh my gosh, so excited. Let's give an extremely warm welcome to AJ Beckles, the voice of Takemichi, Aleks, the voice of Mikey, and Sean Chiplock, the voice of Draken. So excited to have you all here today. Aleks having some video issues, so he was just like, yo, I'm just going to put up a photo of Mikey, and we're here for it. He's also got a little bit of blood in his face, which is very
totally
fitting.
Totally in character for Mikey.
Let's very fitting for Mikey, indeed. But so excited to have you all with me today, and I have absolutely fallen in love with this anime. So I just want to go around, do round robin, and ask each of you about why do you think people have fallen in love with this story? And since AJ is our protagonist, he plays Takemichi, I'll put him in the hot seat first. So go, AJ.
Hi. So I think people really like the show, and if you are reading the source material, because the cast is amazing. Every single character is so lovable, and you're rooting for all of them. But in specifically Takemichi's case, he's just this kid, or technically this guy, that he just doesn't give up. He's on a mission that nobody told him to go on, and he's suffering for the sake of other people, and I think that's really admirable to watch and read.
All right, Sean, why do you think people love Toyo Revengers?
You know, I didn't have an answer for this for myself until I saw one of the first hospital scenes between Draken and Mikey. And that is when I feel like I finally understood what the pull of this show was. So my answer has to be, you know, in media, it's extremely common, if not extremely easy, to use the concept of the Yakuza as this, you know, easy access antagonist group. Like, they're mean, they're violent, you know, they want to harm society, they're no good doers. I can't think of the word right now. They're good for nothings. But
I love it.
I'm sure the Yakuza would say, yeah, we're no good doers. Anyway, so but that scene made me realize like just the entire monologue that Draken gives about how everyone has family, everyone has their own friends, you know, despite how they're acting as a group of people, they are still a bunch of individuals. And I think it's really, really interesting that Toyo Revengers spends so much time focusing on the unique obstacles that members of the groups like Toman and you know their rivals have to go through. And it's not just going around and breaking stuff. It's like protecting their friends. It's, you know, standing up for their ideals, standing up their morals, seeing what their limits are. When we see, you know, where Draken decides to draw the line versus where someone like Pa decides to draw the line, it's a side that I haven't seen ever before when it comes to the Yakuza or those types of groups. And that's why it's a very unique experience for me.
That's a great answer. And no good doers. I'm going to write that down. Sean, that's funny. But Aleks, talk to me about why you think people have connected so deeply with the story.
I feel like for me, there's a lot of elements to it that people can find themselves relating to. Like, the story is really about giving yourself a second chance, and like, if you were able to go back, what would you change? And I feel like a lot of viewers can relate to that. And I feel like the concept of the mystery of how things would go if, you know, things were just to happen slightly different, if you were more knowledgeable, or, you know, if you had the courage earlier. It's a really good story about learning and growing, and I feel like they were able to do it not only through Takemichi, but also through like the rest of the characters. So they had a really unique spin on character development by showing us like these alternate, you know, routes. And I feel like that was really the biggest draw for me, was just to see how everybody grew with different circumstances given to them.
Aw, I love the answers, gentlemen. I'm gonna be completely honest. When I first heard about this show, I was like, what? Like, gangs and time travel, like, I was like, I ain't feeling this. Like, this does not sound like something that I would want to get into. And then I started watching it and fell in love with this story. It has the emotional beats. I'm hate to admit this, love violence, there's blood, you know? And I just feel like the plot is incredibly unpredictable, but here's my tough question for you. The plot of this anime, it's complex. So how would you describe the show to people? Like I try to describe it to people and then I just end up getting like tongue twisted for like 5 minutes, I feel like. So AJ, how would you describe the show for people?
It is really complex. To be honest, when I'm telling people to get into it, I just tell them just watch. Like I know that's not maybe the best answer, but I'm like, just watch, because at first you're kind of like, this is kind of cool, the concept I might have seen before with some time travel stuff, but it's not until at least the episode, for me, I say watch until episode 4. If you're not hooked by the end of episode 4, then, you know, there's something up. But it's crazy.
I love just watch. Like, that's kind of what I'm starting to tell people, too. Sean, how would you describe the show?
I can do it in 6 words. No good doers do good more?
Oh my gosh. Okay, I'll take that answer. Aleks, what about you? How would you describe the show to people?
A bunch of boys having a good time. Time, something time related there.
Actually, that is really witty. A bunch of boys having a good time and just like leaving it at that, because it incorporates the time travel.
I would just put a open parentheses S close parentheses at the end of time and then just leave it like that.
Have the emoji, like, finger on the mouth.
Right. Oh my gosh. So mysterious, Sean and Aleks's, and even AJ's is like, just watch. Okay. But I mean, honestly, I really find the show to be fascinating. And one thing that really got to me was, you know, Takemichi, he gets multiple chances to go back in time. And I found myself repeatedly thinking, is this a blessing or is this like a curse in ways? So I wanted to ask you guys that, like, do you feel like this ability is a blessing or a curse? AJ?
Well, it's actually, and this is something I noticed when I first started like getting into it, and you know, after I was cast, when I dove deep into the source material, the way they do time travel in this is so cool, because Takemichi can go back, but you know, time continues to go forward in the present. So like, if he goes back once, he can't be like, ah, well, I messed up, kind of do it again. You know, he has to roll with the punches, and.
I see what you did there.
Yeah.
Oh my.
It's really cool to see how he handles that, and how time travel is kind of. I think you start to see that I think it's a little bit of a burden, because you know, Takemichi kind of has to put this whole weight on his shoulders, in his alone. But it's a blessing that he can go back and change aspects of himself that he kind of regrets later in life.
My life's ending, and I'm stuck reliving the worst part of it. I hear you loud and clear, God! You're telling me that my life has been nothing but utter shit!
Yeah, I'll be honest. Well, I don't want to spoil anything for anybody watching, but like, there were parts where I was like, this is great! And then there's been parts where I'm like, oh! No, dude.
Stop.
No. Yeah, exactly. So, Sean, what about you? Blessing or curse?
Oh, man. Well, I have a little bit more experience when it comes to characters that have the ability to time travel, more or less. So it's interesting to think about, because you have to be able to think of how other people would view that power, not just yourself, so that you don't have a narrowed opinion of it. And, you know, I've always been a person who felt like, listen, you know, the result of my life is all of the choices that I made along the way. So I would be too scared about, you know, changing one thing and having it have all these unexpected effects and then not being able to go back and undo the undo. So I feel like it really depends on the person who has the power and what they choose to do with it, and if it's forced upon them. So in this specific occasion, you know, I automatically think Takemichi, because that's what I've been saying during this whole show. Takemichi has the ability to choose when he uses the power, which means he has the choice to not use the power if he so decides. But he not only uses that choice, he frequently uses it, goes back, and despite all the struggles that he ends up going through as a result of it, pursues it anyway. So in his case, I would definitely say it's a blessing. And in general, I guess It's sort of what you make of it. Like, it's a harken back to Mewtwo, or Mewtwo in the original Pokemon movie. You know, he's like, we all have, you know, one lifespan. It's not the circumstances of your life that determine who you are, but what you do with your life that determines who you are.
Did you just quote Mewtwo?
I did.
Yeah, you did. And you made it like a life quote. I like absolutely adore you.
Now I'm already on the fast track to become president.
Yeah, I'm like, okay, Sean, bonus points for that for sure. Aleks, what about you? Do you feel like this time travel is a blessing or a curse?
It's really hard to say, like Sean said. You know, it depends on who is using the power. And I feel like personally, if I had that power, I feel like a thing that would scare me personally, it would feel a lot like a curse, because with time travel powers, if you go back in time, would you be living that life again, or would you be going back in time and then jumping forth? And in this case, with Takemichi's powers, you would be going back in time, jumping forth, and you don't know what happened in between there. You don't get to live that life. You don't get to live that context. So when you're dropped back into the present, you're missing out all of these new experiences. And it feels more like tampering than it does, you know, changing something. It's like messing with something, and then you have all of these unexpected consequences that happen. And I feel like I would feel way too guilty about ruining or like changing other people's lives, because even if I do like do good for the sake of like my friends and everybody around me, if I came back to the present and I somehow like, you know, inadvertently affected other people's lives and had more people killed that I didn't know about, I don't know if I'd be able to live with myself with that knowledge or with that, you know, theory in my head. So I feel like I would be too scared to use it.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat. And AJ, I know that you've read ahead, but I'm just like, this show just gets heavy. Oh my goodness. Buckle your seatbelts, y'all. That's all I'm going to say. It's amazing. So good. I do want to talk about your three characters a little bit. So why do you think Takemichi, Mikey, and Draken are drawn to each other? Like, what do they value in their counterparts? So like, AJ, it's more like, what do you think Takemichi loves or hates or whatever? What does he think of Mikey and Draken? And like, same for like Sean, what does Draken think of Mikey Takemichi? Aleks, what does Mikey think of Takemichi Draken? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. That was a complicated answer.
I don't think Mikey
that I gave you guys.
I don't think he just does. That's
no, certainly not. Yeah, but like, I want to pick your brains about why you think that they like each other, what they kind of think of each other. So what do you think Takemichi thinks of the other two?
Well, okay, so Takemichi, and again, something I picked up was like, you know, he has his blonde hair, right? Like, is it called a pompadour? I don't know what that's called, but it was like spiky. Right?
I don't know. But yeah, the haircut is a thing.
Right, but it's very classic, like, delinquent, like, you know, anime culture, like, you know, it's really interesting because you can see his immaturity in that. You know, he's the only one that looks like that out of all the serious cast. Everybody else is just themselves, and they have their jackets because they're representing a gang. But for Takemichi, this is kind of like, he says he wants to be a gang member when he's like, I think 14, I think is his age, 14. But he's not really in it. So now that he's, you know, the present him, you know, looking back, obviously skipped all that, you know, and he's like, you know, I don't want anything to do with it. I'm moving away from my friends. But now he's going back, and all he knows is like, ah, oh, yeah, this is how gangs are. But then he meets Mikey, and he meets Draken, and these are actual like people his age that are gang members, and they're in this world, that's the coolest thing in the world. So you can kind of see this almost slightly unhealthy, you know, admiration for Mikey and Draken, and like how cool they are, and oh my gosh, Mikey kicks so cool, and he stomps on people's faces, and oh, I want to be just like him. And then he gets to the point where he's, as the story progresses, I mean, you're kind of already seeing that. He's like, okay, maybe this, not that it isn't as cool as he thought, but he starts to take things a little bit more seriously. This isn't just a gang, this isn't playing around, we aren't, you know, we're kids, but this isn't kid stuff. You know, people are dying. Fights are happening, and there's very real repercussions. So I think kind of once he realizes that, Takemichi just sees them as two of his friends, you know, just two people that he sees that they're troubled, and he sees that, he has aspects of himself that he wants to, I guess, put forth, set forth, and maybe ground them a little bit. You know, and he's a sweetheart. We love Takemichi.
We love Takemichi. I know he's so cool. He's so cute. But all right, Sean, with Draken, what do you think Draken sees in Takemichi? And we know he admires Mikey for sure. But
I'm about
from your perspective. Okay, let's hear it.
I'm about to get real psychological on you. Okay. So, despite being one of the probably calmest, quietest characters at times in the series, I actually think Draken is one of the most passionate members of not only the gang, but probably the main cast. And in specific regards to both Takemichi and Mikey, I believe that both of them each represent one of the two facets of well, let me just get into it. Takemichi represents Draken's ideals when it comes to a respect and love for others, and Mikey represents his ideals when it comes to a love and respect for the self, which is basically if you got yourself and you got others, then you got your identity as a person. So we think back to when Draken first met Mikey, you know, when he was tasked with bringing Mikey to someone to beat him up because that was his instruction that he was given. And the first point is that he now witnesses Mikey being brought to presumably get beaten up, and Mikey decides, no, you know what? I'm not interested in this. I'm gonna do this my way. You know, you brought me here, now you get to deal with the consequences. And I can totally see Draken going, I respect this. I respect that this man decided to take his own future into his hands and said, I'm not gonna whine and say, oh, it was out of my hands. You know, I couldn't do anything. He was like, I'm gonna do something and see what happens. He took control, and Draken really respects that. And also the fact that after all of that happened, Mikey didn't turn around and go, you know, this is your fault. You're the one who brought me to them. You're an evil person. He goes, damn, that was a crappy situation. Anyway, you want to go hang out? And he's just like, I love that he's able to recognize like the circumstances of the event and how much he had control over and how much was out of his hands. And so Draken immediately attaches to this. He goes, this is a person who understands what they want for themselves. That's the kind of person I want to be. I want to stay close to this person. And then on the other hand, you have the scene where Takemichi was, you know, grabbing his arm and preventing him from hurting Hinata and going, hey, leave her alone. You know, this is my business, not yours. And Draken originally, you know, tries to intimidate him. But when he doesn't back down, he goes, okay, you're serious about this. You know, you are willing to put yourself in danger to protect those that you care about, to stand up for your morals. You have a selfless respect for others. That's also the kind of person I want to be. And that's reflected in the scene that he talks about in the hospital where it's like, hey, you can't just be thinking about yourself. You have to think about how this is impacting others as well. But when the going gets tough, you have to be ready to stand up for yourself. So they both represent different halves of the kind of identity that Draken wants to have. And so even though they have completely different reasons for him being so passionate about them, he's just as passionate about each of them because they're so important to him becoming the person he wants to be.
Oh my, it seems that you've forgotten who you're talking to.
A plus.
Okay, so interview's over. Bye, everybody. No kidding. That was the greatest. I love how he's like, I need water after that. Like, I'm just like, oh my God, that's a great answer.
Sorry, Aleks.
Yeah, I know Aleks is in all of that up, but you know what? But I am interested to hear what why Aleks thinks that Mikey values Takemichi and Draken, because he is so powerful. It's like, why does he feel connected to, no offense, goofy Takemichi, and then Draken, who, I mean, you know, obviously a good soldier, but they have a deeper connection. Like, why do you think he's connected to both of them?
Because they both have blonde hair like him.
Is that it? That's it, obviously. What were we thinking? That is low-key. I'm sure Mikey, no offense, you know, Mikey part of about that. Himself, he's probably like, okay, I can see myself.
I could totally see Mikey being like, if I got both of them to join me, we'd have a total of three brains.
Exactly. Yeah, right? Oh my goodness. I can't. Aleks, is that your answer?
Serious note, though. I feel like with Takemichi, we've explored this, that he sees a little bit of his brother in Takemichi's character, and I feel like you know, even though probably at first he saw Takemichi and he was like, huh, funny wimp get beat up. That's fun. I'll check him out. But then I feel like as he got to know him more, he started to realize there's something special to this kid. There's a quality of myself that feels missing that I really admire in this kid that I haven't seen in a lot of like true gangsters and true, you know, cool, tough guys. And I feel like with Draken, he has a deeper connection with him because, again, Draken is Mikey's, you know, heart, something that he lacks. So in a way, to connect back to Sean's answer, Draken and Takemichi are both parts of Mikey that he aspires to be, even though he doesn't necessarily know that deep within his heart yet. I feel like he's just drawn to them because of their energy and, you know, how they handle their lives. And he's just kind of fascinated in a way and curious about, you know, them and their character. But at the same time, blonde boys, they
it's really interesting.
That was such a good answer, and I was like, oh my gosh, you three are gonna make me cry. And then he ends it with blonde boys. I'm just like, I actually
really like that answer, Aleks, because it makes me think that they kind of represent the a holy trinity. Like Mikey is the brains, Draken is the heart, and Takemichi is the soul. So
okay, just over here, I can't. Like, Sean has put so much analysis into this anime and I love it.
Psychology course at this point.
I know, seriously. Okay, so, you know, we talked about the scene at the hospital. It's funny that we keep on bringing it up because it's extremely heavy, and we see Draken reels Mikey in when these parents are frustrated with him. And I don't know, we've talked about this at length. Basically, this trio, they inspire each other, they influence each other. So I'm kind of reversing this question now. Okay. And I want to ask you how you think your character impacts the others, because you talked about how those characters impacted you. So AJ, how does Takemichi impact the other two?
So I guess the other two as well, but specifically, it's just his own unique qualities. Takemichi is unequivocally himself. Like, he's always him, you know? As much as he regrets the past him or whatever, I think he's able to change so much about himself now because he's had so much time to think at his, you know, older age.
Of 26. So not old, but yeah.
He's described as middle-aged in like all these wikis. I'm like, what?
Oh my goodness. God. Yes, no.
3 years older than me. Yeah. Well, he's himself. And all the aspects of himself, him wanting to, you know, achieve things regardless of him, like with no regard to what happens to himself. And I mean, achieve things, I mean, like, as to make other people's lives better. There's a scene when, you know, Draken and, what's his name? Oh my gosh, Mikey, Jesus. they're arguing and things like this. And, you know, he looks at them and he's like, guys, do you not realize, like, how you affect other people when you're doing this? You know, you're you know, hurting me right now. Do you realize this? And I don't think they do. And that's because nobody has had the guts that they've known to tell them, hey, stop what you're doing. This is not cool. Takemichi looks at them. And again, he almost kind of makes them realize, I think, that they're more than just gangsters. You know, they're more than just a couple of kids that, you know, do bad stuff because that's cool and it's fun. And Mikey, in his case, is his brother and he wants to be like him. And all that's fine, but you're still a human being and there's other human beings and we all have feelings. And you need to realize that what you do has an effect on others, because that's what Takemichi has been forced to learn. You know, his own actions affect others. So he's kind of, in a way, vicariously bringing that same energy to all of his relationships and changing each one with that core aspect of himself in mind.
Y'all are bringing the heavy answers today. Okay, so Sean, How do you think Draken impacts the others? I mean, you said a little bit towards the end there that like he's like the heart.
All right, so I got this scientific journal that I started writing.
Oh, gosh. I'm just kidding. That looked like the Death Note notebook for a second there. I was like, where is he going with this? But yeah.
No. Actually, this time around, my answer is probably a lot simpler. I knew from the start that Draken was the straight man of the group. And I mean that in terms of if you think a comedic straight man duo, you know, he's the guy who's there to ground everybody and remind them, you know, AJ touched on this saying, you know, what you do has consequences. And what I really appreciate is that there are several points in the series where Draken doesn't stop somebody from doing what they're intent on doing because he understands like that's what they want in that moment. But then he's also there in the aftermath to go, okay, you made your choice. Now get ready for the consequences. You know, like he's willing to let people indulge as long as he makes them aware that this is going to have repercussions and I expect you to deal with them. I'm not going to bail you out. I'm not going to protect you from whatever you have to do as a result of this. I'm not going to spare you from the consequences. You make your own choices. You drive your own life and then you deal with the results of those choices. And that's part of what makes him super cool to me is I share that same mentality. And I just really appreciate that he kind of acts as that reality check for everyone else. He's like, all right, this is an anime. We can all have fun. We can all go crazy. But we're also going to deal with the aftermath of that. So just be aware of what you're signing yourself up for because I'm not helping you avoid it afterwards.
Love it. Okay, Aleks, what about for you? How do you think Mikey impacts the others?
I feel like Mikey, in his own way, serves as kind of like in his mind, an ideal bench press for what a true gangster should be like. And I feel like, in his mind, to the others, he's there. He wants to take up this leadership position, and he wants to be a figure of, you know, an example for the rest of the guys. He may not know too much about anything else other than, you know, fighting and a cool gangster with a bike, but I think in his heart, he knows that he's gathering like a bunch of people together and he wants to actually make a brotherhood with them, have a friendship, you know. And I also think that he kind of serves as like the Goku to the group where everybody looks at him and they're like, oh, what a cool guy. I hope I can be that strong one day. Wait, aww, where are you going? Hold on. The guys are beating us up. Goku, come back.
Really? So, who are you?
Takemichi Hanagaki.
It's like honestly the best comparison ever. I love it. So, okay, Sean, I hope this doesn't come off wrong, but it's like...
Already did.
Okay.
Not over. No,
okay. Well, I wanted to ask you guys, like, what do you channel or draw from when you're in the recording booth? And like, no offense, but like, AJ, you're kind of like Takemichi in real life, and like Aleks sounds really cool and just like has like a Mikey kind of aura, but like Draken and you, I'm like, wait, what? You were like super talkative and like bubbly, and then like even when you transitioned to your Draken voice, I was just like, oh my gosh, like I can't, you know what I mean? So I do want to go around and just be like, what do you channel or draw from? For AJ, you have this like innocence and pureness, you know what I mean? So I don't know, I mean, maybe you're stretching a lot, but like to me, it seems like you guys are really similar.
Yeah, no, the as far as personalities is concerned, we're pretty close. And I draw from the fact that like Takemichi is, he wants to be liked. You know, he wants to be, to him, gangsters are cool. So he wants to be a gangster because he wants to be seen as cool. You get hints from, you know, characters like Hinata that, like, I guess the past him was a little bit more juvenile and mean. But that's because I'm sure back then he was a kid and he thought that was what it took to be considered cool because that's all the people he knew. So I relate to that. And I also relate to his now nervous energy where, like, he's kind of afraid. He's used to this. The way his life is, he knows he has to change something, but he's kind of used to the way life is, and that goes from that. I think everybody can relate to that, and you know, maybe not even on deeper levels, even working out or something like that. It's like, yeah, I'd rather stay home and you know, eat some chips. But for Takemichi, you know, he realizes that you know, I have to change because not only am I going to help other people in doing so, I don't like the way I am. And I think there's been times in my life where I've been like, I don't like this. And I've worked hard to change it. And I think that's why I relate to him, and I think that's what I get out of him, and I also think that's why a lot of people relate to him.
Okay. Sean, so who do you draw from?
What was that laughter for? She's like, all right, okay, it's time for Chiplock to answer.
No, like, AJ's like literally like, okay, like I connect with Takemichi on so many different levels, and I'm basically like, you know, like just
right.
has that personal connection. I don't know, maybe they, you have a personal connection with Draken too.
No,
like you
I,
said, you feel that heart connection.
It's a little bit of personal and a lot of technical. Just so I make sure I understand correctly, the question was, how do we connect with the character in the booth and like vocally find our place for them, correct?
Yeah, like it's like, you're not Sean in
right.
there. You know what I mean? Like, you are a completely different human. I mean, like, you become Draken. So, like,
right.
what are you pulling from to become Draken?
Well, I become Draken. I also become Guido Mista. I also become Aleks. I also become Jonah Scott from Beastars. For me, when I'm in the booth, it's a very good example, Draken, of the whole concept of good actors borrow, great actors steal. You know, whenever I approach a character, because at this point, being so blessed to have such a wide portfolio, you start to see a lot of familiarity between characters. Like, oh, this character reminds me of so-and-so. They have the same mentality as this. But what makes them different? And that's where I find the uniqueness that helps me give a different performance is in what makes them different. So from the beginning with Draken, I was like, okay, member of a gang, very loyal to those. Okay, this is a repeat of Guido Mista from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. So I had that as a foundation. But I went, hold on, Guido Mista loves to fight. Draken would rather not fight unless he has to, and he doesn't really get revved up about fighting. He's kind of like keeps his energy level really low so that he only expends his energy when he absolutely has to. And that's what kind of inspired me to say, okay, well, he's a member of a gang, but he's not like, you know, really gruff and angry all the time. He's very, very low key. So I used that to help. I took basically my inspiration from Guido Mista, who was really gung-ho about the whole thing. And I brought it down. I was like, okay, what if doing this was
JoJo's
exhausting?
Characters being gung-ho? What
right.
are you talking about?
So I was like, what would it be like if it was just exhausting to be a part of Tomon every single day? Like, if I'm just like, I'm just standing here and I'm just exhausted and I really want to go to sleep. And you can already hear, like, it just kind of brings your voice down naturally.
Yeah.
And so this, since this was a new venture for me, I said, okay, well, I've played deep-voiced, gravelly, angry characters before. What's an example of a character who's deep-voiced, calm, and stoic that I really, really enjoyed? And I went, Legoshi from Beastars.
Oh.
I've been a huge, huge fan of Jonah Scott's work as of late. And I went, I literally, at one point I went, how would Jonah Scott do this if they had this role? And so I was like, you know, I just brought it down here and I made use of more of my baritone. And you can hear there's some familiar elements there. So I
wow.
combined all of those together, and that's the technical side. And then I already talked at length about my passion for Draken as a character, like where I identify.
Yeah.
So it was just a matter of putting the voice there based on the technical side and then letting my appreciation of the character bring the performance to an authentic level.
I love that answer. Thanks so much, Sean. Aleks, I feel like you're just Mikey. You're just like super cool, have this really nice voice. I don't know. I'm like, what are you channeling? Like, I feel like Sean had the most technical answer ever, and then Aleks is gonna be like, yeah, I'm just me. I don't know.
It's one of those roles that are a lot from like easier for me to slip into because it's part of my higher range, and I feel like those roles are usually easier for me to maintain throughout a long period of time. So in terms of technicality, I feel like it wasn't that hard for me to connect with him, but also personality wise I relate to his carefree attitude of life and how he looks at everything around him, and I'm like, yeah, I also feel like I should relax today. Thank you, Mikey. I will also order 2 kids meal from McDonald's to try to get the Luca toy where the boys turn into fish, but then get 2 of the same cat toys and then be upset about it. Yes. So I for me, it wasn't too much of a challenge, but it was really interesting to explore his other aspects, like his darker side or what he does when he is his true self, like in an environment where he has to fight and protect his friends. I feel like that was really cool to flip between the, hey, what's up? You want to hang out? And like, I'm going to beat you up, little boy. I'm going to beat you up. Back up.
Sorry for the surprise invite.
So, yeah.
I love it. I mean, I just feel like y'all are just perfect picks for your characters, and I absolutely adore it. So there's a lot of heavy scenes in this anime. There's also a lot of comedic scenes. So I wanted to ask you guys, what's your favorite like intense or heavier scene? And then what was like a comedic scene that you were just like, what in the hell just happened here? And you know, one thing that I do love about this anime is that it has that sort of range. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
I don't think you have anime that is just like heavy, making you cry all the time, but, and then you have just sort of comedic anime, you know? And so what I love about this anime in particular is just, it has so many different tones. Like I can find myself like crying and laughing at the same episode. So, all right, heavy moment and comedic moment. AJ, you're in the hot seat.
Oh, it is, it's actually pretty hard for me to, well, not hard for me to answer the question, but, Aleks and Sean both touched on like the technical aspects of finding their character. For me, at first, that was very difficult because he's 26, but then he goes back in time and he's 14, but then he's thinking about things like he's 26. So I'm like, do I want him to sound higher? Do I want to sound more mature and maybe a little bit deeper? My voice isn't that deep, but you know, I was like, what do I want to do? And that took me a while, and you could actually hear it. If you go to the first episode, you can kind of hear me playing around with that. And I think I ended up going with a lighter voice for when he's, you know, when he's in his younger body, because, you know, he's more nervous and things like that. And he's starting to gain that confidence, but he's not quite there yet. And then when he's older, you know, obviously he has his comedic scenes there, but you know, he's more mature and he's like those, that's when you see him get that, like, where you see the confidence kind of like leak through from his experience in the past. So personally, my favorite scene so far that I've done was episode 4, the rooftop scene. I wanted to make sure I got that right. Because I was like, this, not only is this an important thing because it sets the precedent for the rest of the anime, because at first you're going into it and you're like, oh, this is cool so far, everybody's getting beat up, neat. But then some real stuff happens, and I was like, I need to make sure this is good. And in moments like those, I kind of try to bring out that that 26-year-old Takemichi, the one that's a little bit more mature. Obviously, he's still not, you know, super super confident guy, but he's definitely more mature than he was when he was 14. My a funny scene, I think it just came out, episode 6, I believe. Emma walks up. I'm like, the gang's meeting up. Tomon's meeting up, and I show up, and everybody's like, "Who are you?" and everything like that. And Hinata's there because I brought Hinata along because I was with Hinata when Draken called me to come to this meeting. And then Emma pops up, and earlier Emma was, you know, right on top of me.
Oh, that's right.
For reasons we don't know yet, but she was on top of me, and I ran away, and I was like, oh, that can't, Hinata can't find out about that.
Oh my God.
I just imagine when Emma pops up like that, that little doo, 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 doo from like the Andre show, yes. The We'll Be Right Back.
Literally.
Oh gosh.
But seeing Emma there and, you know, like, oh no. And right after that, Hinata being like, so what happened? And then she beats me up, and then, you know, having to, like, I'm like all swollen and bloody, and I have to say, I'm sorry. Like, I'm sorry, Hina.
Oh my gosh, I absolutely adore that. Great, AJ. Sean, what about you? Favorite heavy moment, favorite comedic moment?
Oh man. I feel like I can't cop out and just say that hospital scene with Mike. I really like that hospital scene so darn much. That's a hard. You know what? Go to Aleks. Go to Aleks.
Okay, Aleks, you're in the hot seat first or second.
Heavy moments. We haven't actually gone to a very very heavy moment with Mikey yet. At least not one that I would be comfortable talking about.
Mm-hmm.
But so far, I feel like we have seen hints of his darker side here and there. When he's fighting for his friends, you see a little bit of that like rage and a little bit of that inner demon seep through. And those scenes were pretty cool. And then for comedic scenes, we have a lot. We have a lot, and I feel like that's one of the reasons I really, really love this character, because he's like this badass who everybody admires, and then he's like, I want to go here. I want to take a nap.
Mikey is great. So much range with him. All right, Sean, now it's your turn. What's your answer?
The funny scene definitely has to be, like, one of them has to be the restaurant where, like, Takemichi's trying to peer in and be like, oh, what secrets can I learn? And it's just Mikey going, I want a flag. I'm not going to eat my curry unless there's a flag. Which, honestly, I hate to admit it, but I will, because I'm old enough to own up to my mistakes. I was that kid. If I got a Shirley Temple and there wasn't a cherry and a little umbrella on a stick, I was like, how do I know this is a Shirley Temple and not just a Sprite with red? Which really is just what a Shirley Temple is anyway. It was like, imagine if you got, you know, some restaurants had like that pot of dirt dessert.
Yes.
And it was like the chocolate pudding with like a little Oreo crumbles on top.
Yeah.
Like, imagine being given one of those and they don't put a gummy worm in the pot. Like, what is the point? Why even bother getting that dessert?
I want a toy with my kids.
Right, exactly.
I want a toy with my kids.
It's like that triangle of like, are you the person who orders a single black coffee at McDonald's? Are you the kid who goes, I want to go to McDonald's? Like, Draken's the one that gets the black coffee. Mikey's the one that's just constantly chanting. As for the series scene, you know, it's kind of similar to what he said. There is, if we ignore the hospital scene that I keep bringing up, it's like General Hospital. It just won't go away, pun intended.
It's a great moment though, so I get it.
There is a scene that I have recorded for at least since yesterday that I don't want to talk about yet because I don't want to spoil it for anybody, but I think that scene and everyone's performances has cemented it as probably one of my favorite scene performances of 2021. I heard AJ specifically. I don't know if you got that far yet, Aleks, but just playing off of AJ's lines and like chuckling to myself while barely being able to breathe. And there was just this moment where I could tell that the cast was having so much fun with this, with these situations that we'd probably never find ourselves in real life. It was a really slow moment is how I will describe it. It was just a moment where there's not so much action going on. There's not a bunch of things being said over a 30-second time span. It's just everyone simmering and realizing what their reality is at that point in time. And it that's what makes it hit so hard, is you've just come off of all of this high intensity action. And then it's like time just stops. And when you're forced to just observe and witness what's happening instead of having it told to you, that's when the mind starts to go much, much faster. And I'm very excited for people to see. I think when they see the scene I'm talking about, they'll know what I'm referencing, but that's all I'm gonna say for now.
I look like a Joker monologue for a moment in there. That's when the mind stops.
I know.
You stab one person in the gut and everybody loses their mind.
Oh my goodness, wow. That was great. Okay, you guys, I have some fun questions because we're reaching the end here. So I think like maybe we can answer these ones like a little bit faster. But
all right.
I mean, this group, y'all keep on going off on deep like psychological monologues. So I don't know. We'll see what happens. Who has the best hair on the show, AJ? Go.
Oh wait, has this person been...
AJ, is this going to be a 5-minute answer again?
No, it has to, as of right now, from what we've seen, I think Mikey does.
It's Mikey.
Yeah. Really?
I would ruffle his head and then get kicked in the face, and it would be right so now. Worth it.
Now and forever. No one can beat this.
You know, I kind of feel Akun's hair a little bit.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know. He's got like the curl in the front, but I mean, Mikey's got the locks that are just like flowing in the wind.
Maybe
you're right.
Was born with it. Maybe it's Michaeline.
Oh my goodness. Okay, well, that was an easy answer from everybody. So I feel like Draken, you know, has Mikey. Takemichi kind of has Akun. So who would be your bestie on the show? Okay, I see it marinating.
That's really hard.
Yeah, like what character would be like your bestie? Like who'd be your duo, you know? Who do you think you'd jive with? Oh my gosh, this is a tough one for y'all. Really okay.
You know what? I want to go grab a beer with the dad from the hospital scene. I feel like he's been around the block a couple dozen times. I want to treat him to a nice meal. I want to learn life advice from him. He doesn't get enough screen time. I want to spend time with him.
Okay, AJ.
I say no clue because I'm like, I honestly. Everybody's so cool.
I know, right? Seriously.
Did
Aleks say he wouldn't hang out with any of them?
No.
All right, I'm gonna roll a dice for you, AJ. Hold on.
Yeah, please. Is it a d20?
All right, Izana Kurokawa.
Yes.
Okay, sure.
I probably have to go with. Oh boy, Draken. Draken, I feel like would just
love
be a cool dude to hang out with. Yeah.
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 And he's like intimidating. No one's gonna mess with you when you're around Draken.
Exactly.
That's a good duo to have. Yeah. That's a good. Okay, Aleks. What about you? Who's your bestie in the show?
I'd hang out with Mikey, but not for the reasons you think. I'd hang out with him because he obviously can tell that I'm a weak person, and he knows that I'm harmless. So he won't be like threatening to me, and he would just be like, "Hey, you. Do you want to go hang out?" I'm like, "Yeah."
Oh, okay, I like that answer. How many times do you think the S word has been said on the show?
The S word? Has it been a lot?
Is that the S word? I don't know. The last episode I watched, it said it at least 5 times.
Really?
Sano?
Oh, come on. Okay. Well, I don't actually know what the number is, but I was like, do you guys know, maybe?
No. Darn, now I want a supercut of every time someone says it on the show. Just like one of those 5-minute YouTube videos.
I'm sorry, there are some great one-liners in this. And also, like, it's like not a kid show. So I'm like, you know, it'll be said sometimes. And I'm like, dang, I think it was episode 6. Is that the last one? And yeah. I was like, I should have had a counter. It should have been a drinking game. But okay, y'all don't know that one. Okay, so you guys, a lot of you have done your homework and read ahead or have watched subbed, right? So I thought it'd be funny to ask, rather have a turd on your head or get a temple tattoo?
Sorry, what are the choices?
Turd on your head or a temple tattoo.
Oh, man.
You know what I'm talking about, right? I don't want to like...
No, split. I do. I would go turd on the head. I would
go turd on the head for sure.
I would go turd on the head.
What if we did temple tattoo of a single dot?
Can we get a...
I didn't specify.
Yeah.
Can we get a turd tattoo?
I mean...
No one's getting a turd temple tattoo. No.
I am over 18. You don't control me.
Do not do that. Thank you. Oh, no. I actually have a little tattoo here, and it is excruciating. So really? I don't know how 5th grade Draken did that with a smile, but he did, because he's Draken.
Ken Ryu Puji.
This is Takemichi's wifey, so make sure you take good care of her.
Hmm? Oh my goodness. Okay, so one last question here. Actually, like two. But this one's kind of more towards Aleks and Sean. You guys have like an extremely storied career, and you guys have played so many great characters. Like, I couldn't even like begin to list them off. Mm-hmm. So like, if you took like some of your favorites and put them all in a room, how would that interaction go down? Like, if you, for Aleks, like, came in and Zenitsu and Mikey, like, how would that go down? Does that question make sense?
No, it's fine. Ooh. I just have to look up my own BTVA so I can remember who I voiced.
I feel like none of them would want to hang out. Honestly, I feel like we would be a pretty split group. Like, everybody would just be like, okay, cool. Alligator head man and 20 kids. All right. See you later. Bye. I don't think everybody would be interested in talking to each other.
Right.
I feel like that group would not vibe at all.
No.
Okay, those are bad picks out of your whole career list, but okay, we'll take that answer. They'll just stand there and just walk away. Okay.
Like, when can we leave?
Okay, Sean, what about you?
I think my group would be divided into pairs. Kazunari Takao would be trying to tick off Draken because he reminds him so much of his other buddy in Kuroko's basketball. And Draken would be having none of it, but that's kind of what would egg Takao on. Subaru and for some reason I was thinking of Takemichi. I was like, wait, I don't voice him. AJ, do I have permission to drag your Absolutely. Character into the room so that Subaru can like have green-eyed jealousy over, Aww. Oh, you just have to shake hands to go back in time? Right. What a travesty. What a problem that you're dealing with. It must be so hard for you. Toramatsu is just sitting there going, oh, it's like I never left my house in the first place. It's just this, it's the same crap with different people. And then Frankenstein and D-Luke are just sitting in the corner with like different wine glasses. Or Frankenstein's like, you really should try this wine, you know, it's amazing. And D-Luke's just like, I want grape juice. Grape juice is better. So,
can someone animate that, please? I don't know how we could get it figured out, but that was a great answer. And AJ, you know, this is just such a big opportunity for you. You know, you're obviously a young man and, you know, you have some stuff on your career list too. That's super impressive. But I mean, like, you're the protagonist of the show. Like, how does that feel?
So my first anime role was Shiki Tadamaru and Kimono Jihen. And I booked that. I was on vacation, and I just look at my phone. I was like, "Even cast." I was like, "Well, that's weird." I was really Aww. Excited. And then a week later, I booked this. So these are my only two anime things ever, and I've really only been in the industry since March.
Wow! Like that. Oh my gosh. So
really impressive.
Yeah, I'm very lucky. And I've had a lot of people pushing for me and stuff like that. But to It's actually funny because I remember I auditioned for this and I auditioned for another Crunchyroll show, To Your Eternity. And I.
Oof, both heavy. Oh, but so To Your heavy. Eternity, like real heavy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I had seen To Your Eternity and I was like, whoa, this is awesome. And I auditioned for that. And honestly, I was gunning for that. And then I also auditioned for this. And I booked this, and I was like, oh, what's this Tokyo Revengers? Like, I'm really excited, but I was like, you know, dang, I wanted that.
Weird plot, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, well, then I looked at it, and I was like, this is amazing, and this is not a... This level of complexity isn't something you see often in anime. Every now and then, maybe a couple anime a year will have something this deep, and to be the main protagonist in something like this is so amazing, and it's opened up a lot of opportunities for me, so I'm super grateful.
Yeah, it's definitely a unique, beautiful story. And for the last question, you guys, I just wanted to see if there was anything that you wanted to tell your fans who are absolutely loving this show, because I feel like there's so many of us who were like, what is this? And now we're like, oh my god, it's amazing. So all right, Aleks, I'll put you in the hot seat first. What do you want to say to the fans?
Keep watching. I need my electric bill paid.
Oh my gosh. I can't.
Keep watching. If Mikey doesn't get his electric bill paid, he starts to get real ornery. I don't want to deal with that.
No, but seriously, just I just tell them thank you for watching and thank you for your support. There's so many shows and so many games out there trying to all vie for our time. And there's a lot of cases where we record with projects we're really passionate about and then never hear anything about it, and we just move on. So obviously, you know, just be professional, be respectful about it. But if you really, really enjoyed a performance that we did or how a certain scene went out, by all means, reach out to us. Let us know, because I'm telling you, I can only speak for myself, but when I actually hear someone, when I'm in the thick of work and I have someone say, hey, just wanted to let you know that I finally got to that scene in Tokyo Revengers and your performance as Draken, like, made my day. I will be riding that high for the rest of the week. So, thank you. Thank you for making the effort.
Aw, AJ?
I have to second what Sean just said, and it's because, like, oh man, especially that first recording session, I was beating myself up. I was like, no, I want this to sound good. I want this to sound, and I was so nervous, and I was like, ah, this is my first role, and it's such a cool property. I don't want it to be bad. But seeing those comments of people like, hey, this guy's actually pretty good, or this scene was really neat. And obviously you have a couple people that aren't, you know, the biggest fans of it, and that's okay. But, you know, for the most part, it's been nothing but positive, and I can't be thankful enough. And, you know, and I just got to announce today that I'll be at Anime NYC, so I'll get to see some people that love the show and meet them in person, and that's going to be really cool. You know, I've never had that opportunity before, and it's gonna break my little heart. I might cry a little bit, but yeah.
Well, now both of you made me look bad, so I have to go back on mine. I say what they said, but combined. Imagine I said that, but also a lot more heart.
My gosh, I can't. Okay, well, you guys, it has been an absolute pleasure. Thank you all so much for chatting with me. And the show is absolutely phenomenal. Y'all do a great job. So really appreciate you taking the time to chat with me. But do not forget, you can watch Tokyo Revengers on Crunchyroll right now. And for all of your anime news coverage, stick with Anime News Network. All right. Bye, everybody.
Thank you.
See ya.
He must have been pretty cool.
Yeah, Takemichi. He was a lot like you.
But I'm really not even that into fighting.